Good evening, everyone. I'm Lucy Gray, and I'm the instructor for National Lewis University's Technology and Education course numbered 575, which is focused on staff development. And I've been inviting in various guest speakers. I've been asking friends to come in and talk to, who have different kinds of expertise, to talk to my students about their experiences with professional learning. And tonight, we are, well, it's during the day in Australia, but we're excited to have my friend Anne Mirtschin, who's been involved with my Global Ed Conference for many years and is an extraordinary educator, and Mike Muir, who is head of the MLTI program in the state of Maine. Yay! So we're really excited to have you guys join us tonight and tell us about your experiences, and hopefully we'll have a couple people drop in, but if not, my students can access this recording later on, and it will help them. They have a benchmark project coming up, and which is kind of their final, it's not a paper, but it's a final project where they have to kind of demonstrate knowledge of the concepts we've covered in the course. And we've talked about, you know, adult learning and online learning and things like that. And so these conversations that I'm having with these guest speakers will help them develop something pretty unique, I think, because of these wonderful people who've been joining us. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Anne because she's on a tight schedule because she's in school right now in Australia, and it's her probably her lunch break or something. So thank you, Anne, for coming.
Thank you, Lucy. And I always think it's amazing that I live in your future. So it's actually the day after yours. It is 10:10 at the moment in the morning, summertime. The skies. I'll just show you my school, shall I, outside the window. I don't know if you can actually see it, but nice blue skies. Just lovely weather today, hopefully. So, first of all, I'd like to say I like your word professional learning. I'm going to change the that I'll share to that word rather than professional development. But just to give you some idea, I live on a farm. So we produce wool from our sheep. And we also produce fat lambs. So I live 3.5 hours from our major capital city. I live about 40 minutes drive from the closest city. So for me to be able to attend what we call professional development, or, you know, formal development, it's really, really difficult because I have to travel, I have to be replaced at school. It costs quite a lot of money. So that's why I love technology and the internet, because I have power over what I would like to learn, when, where I would like to learn. So for me, Twitter has been a fantastic source of professional learning. I have put some links on my blog. So Lucy, I'm not sure if the chat shows up in the recording, but if you go to my blog, now let me see if I can share my screen. There's a link to an online document. Those of you who might be listening now can go back and have a look at some online resources where you can learn more about what I'm going to share. There's also another presentation that I gave several years ago about using Twitter. So if you want to and you've got time, there's a space for you to do some more learning or professional learning. So I'd love to share my screen, Lucy, so let me see if I can do that. My desktop, I guess, is it? So you should be able to see my Twitter screen, correct? So I think when you're on Twitter, it's really, really important that you follow a few procedures. So first of all, if I go to my profile, when you join Twitter, really important that you have a photo of yourself or an avatar that consistently represents you. So I've just clicked in my profile there. I think you need, I would next time choose my name to go on Twitter, because people sometimes don't know what your pseudonym or nickname is, but I chose Mirtschin because I cannot spell my name. I think it's really important that you add a little bit about yourself, what you are doing, what your interest is in education. Because if you ask to follow me, I am to follow back. I will immediately go to your profile to who you are, what you are about, what you're interested in, so that I develop a, you know, a professional and a safe network in Twitter. If you've got a blog or other sites that you're a member of and can share a little bit more about yourself, I will often click on that address just to read and make sure you are who you say you are. So that's my blog address down there. So I think it's just very important to have that solid profile. I use Twitter a lot for just personal or professional learning. So if I go to the home screen, you can see the feed that's come from all the people that I follow. But if, for example, I'm really interested in global education. So in the search bar, let me just move forward. In the search bar, I can put global ed. I think we've got 17 on it now. Let me just search for that. So if I search global ed, I can see all the people who are sharing tweets that they think people who follow that hashtag might be interested in. So the hashtag is a searchable item. Once the hash is there, you can go through and search further. So here we've got Germany to spend 5 billion euros on digital infrastructure for schools. I can see what Bronwyn Joyce is doing with her class. They're looking at the importance of water. And someone, a guest speaker or an expert's obviously coming in and speaking to the students. So I could ask her a little bit more about that if I'm interested. There's resources shared. Innovation in education can change the world. So I can click on that link and I can learn a little bit more about what that post is about. All the time helping me learn a little bit more about how I can connect further, learn more about what I can do in my classroom or just for myself. So if I just scroll down, currently there's a blog. So there's a link shared there. So if I click on the link, it will take me to this global blogathon. And it's like an ed camp. People around the world are sharing a blog post a day, I think. So these are some of the people who are going to write, not necessarily about global education, but something that might be of interest to educators around the world. So let's have a look. We've got Making Global Connections blog post by Rahila Mukadal. I hope I pronounced that right. So if I click on there, I can read her blog post, hopefully, and learn a lot more about making global connections, how and why it matters. So if I just scroll through, you can see she's written quite a bit. I think she mentions you, Lucy and Steve. With your global seminars, workshops, etc. But look, here's some activities that you can participate in. So if you don't know about Skype or Padlet or Wikispaces or Google Hangouts or all those other collaborative tools that we might be able to use, there's suggestions of tools that you could use to collaborate further and the links to them. So if I just get out of that... go back to my Twitter feed. So it's just a matter of working out some hashtags that you might be interested in. And if I just quickly go in here, Cybrary Man, and this link is on the that resources sheet. He has set up a wonderful website with educational hashtags. So whether you teach a specific year level, whether you're interested in gaming, in education, whether you're interested in science, all those hashtags are there. So it's a matter of finding one that you might be interested in and then putting it into Twitter and just seeing who is sharing with that hashtag. So we've just had Safer Internet Use Day, which was a cool day. So I'm going to look at safety. I'm going to paste into the search bar. Sorry, all my other pop-up windows will come up. And you can see straight away that we've got the eSafety Office sharing tweets. We've got lots from them by the look of it. Some of them will come up that perhaps don't have as much bearing. Here you can see discussing matters to with these safety ask you threes about the yellow pandas, etc., etc. So again, you can look up the hashtag that you might be interested in, start to read through. But if I go back to Cybrary Man, there are also dedicated chats which are fantastic for learning a little bit more about them. But before I show you that, would there be any questions from anyone? Or Lucy, is there anything you think I should expand upon just with a straight hashtag?
I think they get it. You know, Kelly and Irene have been coming to these webinars. This is the fourth one that we've done, so they probably understand them. And during the last week, they had to follow a Twitter chat. And we use Participate, and I don't know if you've seen, you know, Anne, you're familiar with VIF, you know, the people that sponsor the Global Ed Conference, and they've rebranded as Participate. And they have this whole Twitter interface where you can grab the transcripts of these chats. So this is Cyberary Man's website, and then the Participate chat site are the two that I recommend to people when I'm talking about this too. So I think you've covered everything. His website is just chock full of lots of great stuff in general.
It has. And these are just the education chats. So I love the fact that I can look it up in my time zone and not just necessarily, you know, we're at the time zone of the country that it's being added in. But not only are the chats themselves valuable, the people that have been involved in the chat are certainly worth following, so that you've got them coming up all the time on your feed and you can learn further from them and with them. I don't know if you've covered things like TweetDeck, but I tend to set up a different app so that I can follow hashtags or just see what's happening with the hashtags that I'm interested in.
Yeah, so, we haven't spent a ton of time with TweetDeck, so this is good. This is really helpful.
Okay. So just some of the hashtags that I date with all the time, I will actually, all you've got to do is put TweetDeck either as an app or I think Twitter themselves have taken it over, and you can search in Twitter. So if I'm interested in Ed Chat, whoops, I'll put it for the hashtag. I in that search bar, I go Ed Chat, and sorry, I should have put it up here. Ash Ed Chat. I search for with that little magnifying glass. Then if I wish to, I can add that column onto my tweet deck. Wait a minute, is that coming up? So I can add it as a column here. So now if I come across, I don't know if my window is hiding that. If I come across, let me close that. You can see all the tweets from people who are sharing information or resources about EdChat. So, you know, here's a guide for iPad, EduCat. It's great stuff, especially if you're just beginning with technology in the classroom there. The visuals, there are 12 narrative writing techniques. Just lots and lots of things for you to go off and explore at your own pace and at your own rate. I hope to attend ISTE, the big conference, technology conference in America this year at San Antonio. So I've got that hashtag ready because there's things being shared about what's going to happen, just things being shared with people who might be interested in topics that might be shared there. In Australia, we have a Victoria PLN. So that's quite local for me. So I like to know what the people, you know, in my area and district are doing and sharing as well. So there's a big conference coming up that I might like to go to, etc. So TweetDeck lets you see a lot of the hashtags that you're really keen to keep up to date with, you know, all in one space. So I don't know, this Hootsuite, what else do you use, Lucy, to sort of keep track of the hashtags?
I think I basically just use this and I use Participate chats. I haven't found anything that's better really in general, but I want to say like maybe once a day I log into TweetDeck to see if I've missed anything that I'm tracking. I'm more apt to use just the regular Twitter app in general. The one thing that I'm starting to do more too is I use, I do something kind of on steroids. I use Paperly, which is a digital newspaper tool, and I actually pay for the premium version of it. And I do this with a couple of different feeds. So one is, it takes my list of, in Twitter, I make lists of people. And so one of them takes all of my Apple Distinguished Educator friends and makes a newspaper out of that. And I'll put the links in the Twitter chat. And then another one is all global ed stuff. And it takes, tweets from people who are doing work in the space that you and I are working in. And it puts out a paper twice a day. And then recently, because of all this fake news stuff, I've put together a list of like really reputable news sources and people who are interesting journalists. I kind of have dug into like who are the leading New York Times people, who are the people of the Washington Post, you know, people like that. And I put them all into a Twitter list. And then that list feeds into Paperly and again publishes a little mini digital newspaper of really high quality stuff so that I don't have to go looking for all this. And so I'll put the links in there if you guys are interested in looking at it. But that's probably the other tool that I use to complement all this.
Okay. So if people are interested in following lists or creating lists, I have clicked on my profile and you can see that there are 41 lists there. So I've actually set up some of these lists. So in my own school, if I click there, I've got the people, the staff at the school. And so it's keeping up with the tweets they might be sharing. So if it's classroom, Twitter ID, teachers. So I just put that as one of my lists. Some of my lists aren't very up to date, so I've got to go back and do it. So if I just go back for a minute, I can also see the list that I'm a member of, and I think this is really valuable. So I'm a member of the Global Citizenship. So someone has actually set up a list of, as you say, high quality or appropriate people to be following, etc. And so if you subscribe to their list, you actually tap into their network as well. Now, what I had, so Lucy set up a list called Global Education Conference Volunteers. So you know that those people are going to be active and valuable. So if I click on that, these are all the people that Lucy has added to that list. And I can have a look and see what they're tweeting about and sharing with them, with the people who are on Twitter. So here we've got being culturally responsive classrooms with digital content. Lots and lots of exploration that can do. You can lose yourself here for hours on that if you want to go off and learn more. But the more specific you are with your hashtags and maybe people, you know, the probably the more valuable resources you'll get. So if I go back to my list, it's very easy for you to actually create a list. Somewhere it gives me the option to create a list here. So you simply click on create new list, and then you start to give it a name. Then you start to pull in all the people that might tweet or use that hashtag, or that, you know, a part of that type of learning, etc. So that's just a snapshot of lists. I'm sure if you search online, you'll get a little video that will actually step you through that for you. On that sheet that I shared with you, and this is a sheet that I've shared, it just talks, there's some links on how you should actually participate in a Twitter chat. There's a visual guide, step-by-step guide. Some of the hashtags, got one link there for people who are Australian focus. Where can you find Twitter chats? I like Shambles Guru, he's an Asian educator. So I like his resources and what he's doing. There's some webinars that you can go into, some different tools for following Twitter chats. And then if you want to host a Twitter chat, that's always a really valuable thing to do. You can promote it on Twitter. How do you go about it? It will tell you there, etc. There's just lots and lots of resources to help you actually use that in a valuable way or manner. So I don't know if there's anything I thought I should cover, Lucy. Let me just go on that. It's just very much maybe of lurking for a little while and then getting really active in it.
Yeah, and I think the trick is, like, you jump in when you can. Like, every Thursday night is Global Ed Chat for me, and they have a different theme every week, and some themes appeal to me better than other themes. They're really organized. But it also depends on my schedule. Like, I don't feel guilty if I can't make it, but sometimes I just drop in to say hi, or I'll go back and look at the transcript of it and participate, you know, and see what resources were mentioned that I missed. So that's another strategy. The other thing, and you might want to mention too, is, you know, Anne has been really instrumental with this online global education conference that I run, and she's on our advisory board and volunteers. And when everybody goes to sleep here in the US, she and a couple other Australian educators are running things for the conference because it goes around the clock 24 hours. And I don't know what we would do without our Australian friends keeping the thing going. But what I love about Anne in our conference is that she does a couple of sessions that are very interactive in a webinar format that are really geared towards kind of newbie people. Like, how do you get started? How do you get connected? So that's why I highly recommend following Anne, because she's really good at teaching the basics of global collaboration, including Twitter, to people. But the thing that really has struck me is that she's part of this group called Hello Little World Skypers. And I think that's also a really good, you know, finding your tribe, finding your community, I think is a big part of people's professional developments. Do you have a link that you could share with that, Anne, or tell us anything about it before you run?
I can, but just before I do, I forgot to say that if you can't participate in real time in the chat, Twitter chat, they're usually archived. So it's a matter of finding the chat that you're really interested in, where they archive it. So often it's done in what's called Storify. So it's a matter of finding that link. So just to looks like, this is just one that the Global Classroom Chat Archives has. So you can go in there and you can see the whole Twitter feed or chat. Again, you've got people you might like to follow. You can actually see what they've talked about, etc. Okay, let me show you Hello Little World Skypers, because for me, they've got a Google Sites website, which I hope is here. So this is an amazing group of educators around the world, from Nepal, Africa, Australia, America, Europe, Russia. I think we have a lot of countries covered. So again, if you search for HLW Skypers, you will see a site that's been set up. So we share a little bit about ourselves. If someone's done a presentation, it's shared on there. Our map, let me see if I can find the map quickly as to where we're from. Oh, that's our visitors. I should have looked this up before I came. Why Global Ed? Maybe it's in here. But, you know, there's people already done presentations shared now on there. Why should we do global education? There's recipes. There's, you know, we've shared recipes across ourselves. Oh, our global education conference presentations are there. Oh, here's our map. There's a calendar, so a calendar of events that we might be interested in. But all the time...
Look at that. That's a lot of people.
It is, but they're not a lot. They're not all active, and that's what we really want, is people who are passionate, want to be active, etc. So, you know, it might be a spontaneous thing. Who can do a mystery Skype with me now or in 10 minutes' time? Could someone help me test, you know, the new tool that I'm playing with? So we've done things like Kahoot together, Skype, Google Hangouts, Padlet activities, all sorts. So, yes, if you are learning in classroom about Italy, you could just click on one of those pins and it brings up the name of the person who – oh, sorry, that she's not Italy. I think she's Hungary, sorry. So, you know, if you're studying Hungary, there's the contact for you straight away. Why not get the person who lives there come and speak to your class or to you to tell you more about what it's like, the affairs that are happening now. Let me go back. Somewhere we've got like our recipe book, which is rather interesting because, you know, we all have different foods and different things to do. There's just, you know, there's animal web cameras that are live out there. So someone shares, you know, we can go live and look at one of the African waterholes, Houston Zoo webcam, etc. So it's just lots of fun things. You could get lost in there as well. Do you want me to?
I love my favorite webcam one. I get hooked into these just from like Facebook. And my favorite one is explore.org. And it depends on the time of year, but like during the summer, they're filming up in, a national park in Alaska, the grizzly bears who are capturing all these leaping salmon, in a stream in the middle of Alaska. And it's mesmerizing to watch that. So that's my personal favorite is explore.org. For webcams.
There's an Earth one too that's great. But look, you know, because it's dark in Africa, they're asleep. You wouldn't see. But there's a webcam set up at a watering hole, and you see the hippopotamus and the rhinos at times, if you're lucky. It's an amazing thing. And students get a concept of time zone differences as well, you know, if you can do that live. Anyway, that's a little bit about hello. Yes, find your tribe. Find who you're going to be comfortable with, and they will support, mentor, share. You know, there's so many here willingly and freely with you. And are your education students, Lucy?
These are graduate students, so some of them are teaching. Most of them are basically teaching. Irene here has a business that does cultural awareness programming and, you know, after school programs and that sort of thing as a, you know, a supplement to schools. Okay. And most of the people in the class are enrolled in a technology and education program. That's, you know, that's the graduate program that's focusing on, I think, Irina's curriculum and instruction though. So they all have some sort of teaching background for the most part.
So I love that intercultural, learning too, and I just think Twitter is a fantastic tool. It's free, it's there all the time for you to learn, you know, whenever it suits you, etc. So if you are on Twitter, push it to more boundaries and just keep on learning, share, find the people that will help you, support you, who might come into your classrooms or space and work with you. Don't know if there was anything else. Was it the archive? Are always there. There's new apps coming out all the time.
Yeah, I'm finding that like the tried and true works for me. Like there aren't too many things that are brand new and shiny that I want to, you know, that I think are better than what I'm currently using, like, you know, TweetDeck and you know, it's interesting. Like I think once you find something that works for you, it's really it's hard to keep moving around. You know, if you find something that's effective, stick with it. You don't have to, you know, be too fancy with things. Kelly and Irene, do you have any questions you want to ask Anne while she's here? And Irene, you might want to look at the front page of the Hello Little World Skypers page. There was a link there for adding your information and joining the group. I joined their, they have a Skype group. All the teachers in that group have a Skype group where they're talking on a regular basis. And I had to mute myself at some point because I was getting like 5 million messages. They were a really, really active group. It's almost instantaneous. It's almost like a texting group that they have in Skype. So I muted it, and I don't know if I left it or whatever, but I don't see the Skype notifications anymore.
One other thing.
Yeah.
Twitter is a translate option. So I'm trying to find a tweet that was written in a different language because, you know, you can still follow people even though they don't speak English. Twitter lets you click translate. But I usually Dondi. Wait a minute. So can you see this tweet here? So Dondi. I think she was in Hungary. I can actually click on the so at the moment I can't read what she's saying, but if I want to learn what she's saying, can you see I click on that translate from Hungarian, and then it pops a Hungarian and American, whatever, etc., a meeting for in a Skype classroom, etc.
That helps a lot. I haven't noticed that. I've noticed translations in Facebook, but I've not noticed it in Twitter. So that's no, really helpful.
But what you need is someone to follow who tweets in a different language, otherwise it doesn't show up. So obviously Twitter must work out that I'm English. Well, it would, I guess, with my profile. And it gives me that option. So let me see if she's got another one there. That's so sometimes she tweets in English. Sometimes, oh, here's another one in, this one's in Romanian. So if I click on that, there's a sailor sailing around the world. Oh, this time Twitter couldn't translate that tweet. So it usually does the first time I've seen that pop up. So, yeah, don't discount people because they don't speak your language. Learn with them and from them too. The other apps and tools that come with that.
Well, that's really cool. That project she's looking at, I've seen, I don't know too much about it, but it's a guy that's like sailing around the world. And he, I want to say he left the U.S. maybe in November. I just have a vague recollection. It was like starting about the time that I went to France last fall. But yeah, I also follow people like this Bendy Global guy on Facebook too, so that I get notifications there. So like Facebook has become kind of my a big source of resources for me. So I follow them on Twitter. I usually try to follow people in multiple channels, because you never know what's going to pop up from an organization. And some organizations are so good with really making the most of all the different social media tools out there. Like Edutopia, obviously, is great in Pinterest and YouTube and Twitter and Facebook. Another one that I love for special ed is understood.org, which is, it's all about special ed stuff for parents. But teachers would find it useful, and it's four organizations that are putting the content together. It's Common Sense Media, it's CAST, which is a special ed group, and LD Online, and someone else, and awesome resources. So, and they have just a great presence across, you know, all these different channels. And I think, you know, it's important to kind of, you know, look at the different ways, and maybe there's one particular channel that you find are more comfortable with in terms of finding stuff than another. But I think Twitter is probably the most interactive.
Yeah. I might just show, I do think that not only do you do your own professional or personal learning, sorry, I'm just going to go to my blog. You know, it's great for learning within the classroom. So my students were studying, I had the little five-year-olds. I usually teach older students, but I had, sorry, I'm going to click through very fast because I want to find this slide that shows you. They were learning about animals. So I put out a tweet for people to share what was their favourite animal. I put out tweets so that I want to know what the weather is because the students might graph it in like a spreadsheet, etc. So I find that that personal learning goes beyond just your own professional learning, but into the classroom too. Sorry, I'm nearly out. Going too fast for you. But this is sitting on my blog, this particular one. So in the classroom, I simply asked, I've gone past it again. I asked people to share their favourite animals. So we got replies from Canada, Asia, America, etc. But one person said they liked the red fox. Well, my students were horrified because we live on farms, and you know, this red fox, the foxes cause a lot of problems for the sheep. They take the lambs, kill them and eat them, etc. So it brings in a whole lot of extra learning, etc. There were all sorts of different favourite animals shared with these little ones. And it just took us to another dimension. I used Twitter again to see, because we live so far from anywhere, if an author would come in virtually and present to the students. So I used a hashtag author, and that's the only way I can think that it came to the notice of Christopher Hurst. So he actually came in at lunchtime he spoke to the whole school, first of all, about his love of reading and writing, because it was book in Australia. And then he did 2 years' worth of 6 or 7 lessons at lunchtime with those students who wanted to develop their writing skills further. So, you know, we've used Twitter. The students sometimes have a back channel in Twitter, so that if we're watching a live event, are sharing what they feel about things. So one of my students was talking about the cost for rural students of going away from home to the city. And in the Twitter back channel, we had students saying, well, it costs us a lot of money too. Why should you be you know, when we need it as well? So Twitter is just a really powerful tool, I find, as Lucy said, in conjunction with lots of the others, to be able to learn more, either personally, with your class, etc.
One thing I'll say about the author stuff, I think I want to say that there's a website somewhere where there's a list of authors that will Skype with classrooms. We did it with a class I worked with in CPS at Falconer. It was Falconer School, Irene, which is, I think, kind of near you. And we had a grant, and we had money set aside for, it wasn't a grant, it was a thing funded by a company that was doing a pilot. And there was money set aside to have the author of the book that they were reading do a hangout with us. And it was great, but I mean, I think it was, I don't know, not every school can pay for someone. So it's great when an author will volunteer like that. The other thing I was going to say too, I'm going to forget what I was going to say. I'm losing my train of thought. I like how you're using the most of your lunchtime there. And that was one thought also, like what are some informal times that you can have informal professional development going on during your school day? And some people used to do that with our Global Ed Conference. They would turn it on at lunch while everybody was eating, and then they could take in some of the sessions. There was something else I was going to say about the author bit. Oh, I know what it was. On Twitter, you can make your own polls now, which I think are fairly limited, but you could make a poll, a survey for other classrooms if you want to conduct, you know, and get real research on something. So use Google Forms and create something that, you know, a 3 or 4 item survey, send it out over Twitter with a hashtag and get people to respond. And what's powerful about it is that you can also open up a spreadsheet for your kids to look at and project it. And while people are responding, you'll see the data come in real time. The first time I did this was at a librarians conference, maybe 7 years ago. It was a long time ago. And I asked people what their favorite genre was to read and where they'd like to read, and opened up the spreadsheet for all the people I was presenting face-to-face to, and sent the question out over Twitter, the format over Twitter, and boom, we could see people respond really quickly. And I think for kids, it's pretty powerful. You can always ask questions like about water usage or your favorite animal, or, you know, simple questions that will help you gather real data. You're muted.
I see someone asked what school I'm at. So I'm in Victoria, Australia. So it's a small country school. We have 220 students, age 5 to 18. The town that they're in has 120 residents. So we are small. So this personal learning, professional learning, being able to use technology, etc., is so essential for the distance across the effort to find it face-to-face. So I've just written in the chat. I was just looking to see if there were any other questions in the chat.
I think we're good. I like your idea too for Edmodo groups. That's great. You know, and Anne lives on a sheep farm. And so when she's helping with our Global Ed Conference, I think it's during lambing season, and like you run out to do things with the lambs and then come back and help with our conference. And it's great. It's a great learning experience for everyone in general. So I know that you have to go do yard duty, which I'm assuming is you're going out to supervise your students, and I don't want to keep you. But, and this is awesome, and I'm hoping that Irene and Kelly will at the very least, will follow what you're doing and get involved with some of the things that you've been up to. And you know, it's always good to see you. Are you coming to ISTE again this year, Anne?
Yes. Yes, I certainly hope to be coming to ISTE. I've just shared that my blog post that's got the links to that Google document. And I might try and make, I think it's open. So if you want to put anything on there, Lucy, please feel free to do so.
Okay.
And I'm at Mirtschin on Twitter if you want to follow me.
And then you have a, there's a student behind you.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, oh, I'm right next door to the printer.
Okay.
So we have really got students in our school. Woo! So it's now about 10:45. It's morning. We call it morning recess. What do you call it?
I don't know. I guess recess. I mean, kids usually go to recess after lunch, typically. It really depends on where you are. And, yeah, you know, I guess. So we're going to, when we're done recording tonight, it's about 5:45 at night where I am, the day before you. When we're done recording this, I will put it up on YouTube, and then you know, people can use this ongoing. All these sessions have been so great, and nothing beats bringing in guest speakers like this, as opposed to me babbling at my students. And I know who's doing good work in this space. And so it was exciting when I put it out there on Facebook and said, "Who wants to help out?" And all my favorite people came forward. So this has been a treat, and I know that these sessions are going to live on past just this live session. So thank you, Anne. And if I can ever do the same for you in some capacity, just let me know. I'd be happy to do that.
Okay. Thank you. And great to present. Thanks. Okay. Thanks for letting me present. See you, Lucy.
All right. We'll talk to you. I'll see you in June, if not sooner. Okay?
Yeah. See ya.
Thank you, Anne. Bye. So I'm still here. There's Mike. So here's our next special mystery guest. And Mike is, I've known, how did I first get to know you, Mike? I'm trying to think.
I was following you on Twitter.
Yeah.
And you were following me. And we were down in Florida, I think, at the FECA conference one year. And yeah. Went to a tweet up.
No, that's not it. I know what it was. I met you at iSummit. You were one of the keynote speakers at that school in Atlanta.
You and I knew each other before iSummit.
Really?
Uh-huh. You played a role in getting me invited to iSummit.
I did.
Uh-huh.
Really? Are you sure it was me?
Yeah. Oh, wow. Yeah.
See, okay. And I just remember at iSummit, we were playing with that one app and harassing people who were
keynoting,
which was Hologram or Holler something. And you guys, it's Hologram, and this is an app which I wouldn't use with students because there's some things that are not very appropriate. But you can make these little signs. It started at South by Southwest, and you can show it to the keynote speaker or whoever. It's coming. It's taking forever.
And on the tablet, it's larger.
Yeah, and this is probably showing you the mirrored version right now. It's probably not mirroring correctly, but so then you can hold it up and harass the speaker. And so we were doing that to poor Mike and Ted Lai, who I think was the other speaker.
Year. As I recall, there was a large number of us that spent an awful lot of time laughing during that conference.
Yes, we did. We did. And I was just up in Mike's corner of the woods, keynoting his summer workshop with his teachers. And I loved it. I love Maine teachers. I think it's because I think pedagogy comes first.
That's what we're working on.
And if you're not familiar, Irene and Kelly with Maine, and I'll let Mike tell you a little bit about it, but they've had a one-to-one laptop program for 15 years now, Mike?
Yep, 2002.
Okay. So they really they've gone through everything, I mean, with technology. And I think it's a journey. It's not something that you do and you check off something on a list.
And we haven't arrived yet. We're still on that.
Yeah. So we've talked, Mike and I have talked a lot about everything. And recently we've been talking about, I've been working with a school in Wilmette, helping them come up with an innovation plan. And Mike had shared a lot of resources from his blog with me that has really guided our process. So I want to thank you for that, Mike. But I'm just going to let you talk and talk about, I think your view is going to be a little bit more unique than some of our other speakers in terms of professional learning. So I'm really excited for what you have to say. And Irene and Kelly, make sure you ask lots of questions. And Mike, just why don't you give us a little bit of an idea of your background and how the MLTI program started and all that? Because I think
sure. That would be really helpful. So what I think what I'd like to do is, I am going to share a link and some resources.
I can find the, I tweeted out the
there. I just, okay. Yeah, I just reposted it. And then I think what I'd like to do is, Irene and Kelly, I'm going to share some slides just to give some context and background and then leave a lot of time for questions. So I haven't shared my screen before, so let's see.
You just click share your screen and then you pick the window you want to show.
Nice. Oh, yeah. Good. It is showing me a little bit about what's showing up.
Yeah, I like Zoom. I think it's pretty easy to use.
Okay. So when Lucy invited me and about 100 other people to come and participate in her course, the piece that I wanted to have an opportunity to talk is proficiency-based professional learning. And it comes from our work with not just MLTI, which I'll talk a little bit more about in a minute, is the proficiency-based diploma state. And districts are working now on a pretty steep learning curve to figure out what it is, what proficiency-based learning is and how we document that and what a proficiency-based diploma is like. But I'm not going to talk so much about that as I am the insights it's given us to not offering workshops, but making sure that professional learning is proficiency-based. So there's that same link that we just threw in the message bar. And so if folks are this video, you'll still have the link. And so as Lucy mentioned, we have first and still only statewide one-to-one learning with technology initiative. It started in 2002. It was the idea of our governor, Angus King, who's now our senator, Angus King. And he really wanted to make a difference. He recognized the degree to which the economy was changing in Maine and really wanted to leave an impact and was really forward-looking. He also worked very closely with Seymour Papert, who had a lot to do with, I think Seymour was the angel on his shoulder, giving him all the ideas about how MLTI ought to work. So we've been one-to-one in 7th and 8th, 2002, teachers and students. And over the years, we've opened it up so that districts can buy in at district expense at other grade levels. And we now are serving 376 schools, K-12. State still provides state funding support for 7th and 8th grade. And if that doesn't sound like a lot of schools, keep in mind that Maine is slightly smaller than Houston Public Schools. So we've got only about 170,000, 180,000 students K-12 across the state. So we're kind of small by numbers, but I think that's part of why we've been able to be successful. Currently, we serve about 66,000 students. 15,000 teacher seats, K-12, and including all an eighth grade student teachers. And it's that work that really got us thinking about proficiency-based professional learning. So a recent study done by the Digital Promise or in partnership with Digital Promise shows that teachers, it's interesting, there's 100% participation in required professional development at schools, but a very low satisfaction rate, somewhere between 20 and 30% satisfaction rate. And yet almost 80% of teachers participate in professional development on their own. And the thing that drives them to do that is they want to learn more skills or hone their existing skills. They want recognition for learning and applying best practices. They want skills that are going to help them in their own classroom. And they want validation for their competencies. I think a lot of that dissatisfaction around required professional learning is that too many teachers don't feel like it applies to them or don't understand how it applies to them. And But frankly, if we're doing professional learning with teachers, we don't just want them to attend a workshop. We want them to actually go back and apply a skill and learn how to use that skill and do that. There are some wonderful systems out there for bringing professional learning to teachers. One of them that some of our schools use has a whole lot of online webinars. And the interesting thing is they also have a average sign-off time of an hour and a half after the workshop ended, which means they logged in and then they went and did something else, maybe their laundry or cooked dinner, and then came back long after the webinar ended and logged out. And so we don't really just want attendance. We really want people to learn and get better at those skills. So I wrote an article some time ago on proficiency-based professional learning. It's a document I shared with you. And for me, regular workshops fit within that middle category, support for foundational knowledge. So the workshops often teach a teacher the new strategy or some background information. And we'd really like to re-envision those as kind of same page sessions, that if we really want teachers to get good at this, this is an opportunity to develop a shared vocabulary or a shared understanding of the strategy. And that can be done live or it can be done through recordings, for example. And that's what we mean by reusable learning objects. But it's also really important that if you want a teacher not just attend the session, that you have an opportunity for teachers to develop some clarity behind it. So perhaps your initiative should have a professional learning curriculum. What are the skills that teachers ought to learn to be considered proficient in that innovation? And you need some sort of a progress management system. A lot of our schools are recognizing with a proficiency-based diploma that a system that helps you track of which learning targets a student has mastered is very different from a platform that helps you keep track of grades on assignments. And we need the same kind of thing for professional learning. How can we show, is Lucy at a novice level or beginning, or is she applying it, or is she really gone beyond proficiency? And I think the thing that teachers need the most early on with any kind of innovation is opportunities to see examples, whether they're live or recorded, or text stories. They want to know what does it look like, and it's such an important critical piece to being able to implement this. In fact, I think, and sometimes they're having an opportunity to see what it looks like, it almost needs to come before the same page session. And then I think the thing we do is we forget that once you attend a workshop, you need some support trying it in the classroom and seeing how it goes. So lesson invention and tryouts need to be counted as professional learning time. Coaching and feedback, whether it's a peer or a learning coach or a literacy coach or a tech coach, and giving you some feedback on how to get better at it. And frankly, teacher face-to-face time is invaluable for having an opportunity to talk with teachers about what you're being successful with, what's being challenged. At the very beginning of MLTI, we had job-alike sessions. So all the tech leads got together in a room, librarians in a room, teachers in a room, principals in a room. We did these regionally. And they would have conversations about what they were doing and what was working and what wasn't. And invariably, you'd see someone go, well, we've tried this and it doesn't work. And it wasn't the workshop leader, it was some other person with the job they had in that room that said, oh, you know what, we had the same problem and this is what we found worked. And that face-to-face time to talk about challenges and successes is amazing. Lucy, I saw some activity that I think is on the list. Did some questions pop up that I should address now or should I keep going? All right.
I think you're good. I've been babbling in the chat and adding resources as you've talked about things. So that's just me talking.
Terrific.
Okay.
All right. And you'll stop me if a question comes up that we should address right away. So if you're going to talk about proficiency-based professional learning and you're thinking about technology and tools, you have to ask the question, proficiency in what? And I it, one of the hardest lessons we've had, and we're still fighting in Maine years later, is that if technology initiative is to have technology in the classroom, when you're successful, all you have is technology in the classroom. And not only that, in all likelihood, you've got kids who are distracted and off task and not doing what they're supposed to do. There's got to be something more than just having technology in the classroom. So Mark Prinsky, the same guy who coined the phrase digital natives and digital immigrants, also coined the phrase more verbs, fewer nouns. So it's the idea of let's talk more about what we want to do with the technology than about the devices and tools itself. Let's offer workshops, for example, in how to analyze data, and teachers will leave knowing how to use a spreadsheet and formulas instead of doing a workshop on spreadsheets and formulas. And you know, there's no doubt that something like what Ann just did, a quick introduction to Twitter for professional learning, that's a tool-focused workshop, but it's got to lead to something else. And she did a good job of connecting it back to the professional learning pieces. But we've got to take it even farther and talk more and more about what's good professional learning. And then the tools help fill that out. We can't just stop once we've talked about the tools. So as David Guerin says, classrooms don't need tech geeks to teach. We need teaching geeks who can use tech. So really the most important thing we're looking for is this focus on pedagogy. And we've developed in Maine what we call a plain English instructional model. And our job, we're not trying to replace any other instructional model anybody else is using, Danielson or Marzano or anybody. What we're really saying is whatever model your school is using, let's make sure it addresses these five areas. And as we could almost just take out tech four throughout all of this. What we want are teachers who have strategies for helping students build foundational knowledge, strategies for practice and deepening understanding, strategies for putting knowledge to work, strategies for assessment, evidence, and formative feedback, and strategies to help build student motivation and engagement. And so whatever the model you're using, make sure that you do the crosswalk to the kinds of things. And then don't tools like Google Docs, but think of what are the strategies I would use different areas that a tool like Google Docs or something completely different could help me with. And then we also developed the Maine Learning Technology Framework. We had so many people who lived in the learning-focused access area. Do they have devices? What's their connectivity? What apps are on there? That was the center of their technology world. And it really lost the focus of technology for what? And so we did the Maine Learning Technology Framework. We put student learning right in the middle. Our shared vision for learning, we make sure we say vision for learning because it's not a vision for the school, it's not a vision for ed tech, it's a vision for the kinds of learning experiences you want your kids to have. And then it's supported by these important pillars, hold it up. So the professional learning, leadership, which includes positive pressure and support, setting expectations, supporting the heck out of people, making the professional possible. And it includes learning-focused access. And we're defining learning access as kids having access to the devices, apps and tools, and connectivity they need as they need for their learning. So we're not saying as they need for everything, but we're really trying to drive access to the point where kids have what they need when they need it for their learning. One of the other things we did was we changed the district technology plan requirements. It used to just be, what are you buying for stuff? What are you doing for Wi-Fi? What are you doing for telephony? And we've aligned it now to this framework. And they have to say what their vision for learning is. And they have to say what they're doing for professional development and how they're executing learner-based access. And we're partnering with a group called Bright Bytes that has a pretty high quality, valid and reliable technology and learning survey. And they've done custom reports for us that map onto this framework. And so schools, I talked to a superintendent this year who in the regional superintendent's meeting got real angry real fast and said, I was really mad that you made us do a survey, and I was mad that you made that you changed the format for the tech plan while we're working on the tech plan. And he goes, now that we've turned it in, I am so glad you did that because it shifted the whole focus now onto learning. And if you're spending too much time talking about the tools and devices and not enough about the teaching and learning, you're really not going to find out what the bang for the buck. So one of the ways that we're thinking about how do we focus on learning, how do we do and implement proficiency-based professional development is through educator micro-credentials. And of course, the metaphor that goes back is to scouting merit badges, whether it's Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts, where the scout has a list of things that they need to know and be able to do. They have to demonstrate their mastery or proficiency in those things. And then they earn this badge as a of what they have accomplished. And so digital badging, and I'll tell you that digital badging is really about acknowledgement. And it's about knowing in a verified way. If I have a micro-credential around using quiz programs for formative assessment, then that has information connected to that badge that if my principal looked at it, they would know, oh my gosh, look what Mike has done. Yes, he absolutely understands how to use quiz programs for formative assessment. They're also more granular. On purpose, they usually focused around one major competency or skill rather than courses that tend to focus on a whole bunch of things. And the badge platform can also be a discovery system. If any of you have kids in Girl Scouts or Boy Scouts, those merit badges are available online. And when you go online, you can just kind of browse through them, and you may be looking for something that you know already you want to do, but you also stumble across things that you didn't know you could earn and that were interesting to you, and you go back and do that. And that discovery can be really invaluable in professional learning as well. And digital badging has really grown up around HOS and video gaming. And so there's a lot of administrators and decision makers that don't like the badging for that reason. And what we want is a term that's serious and professional. And so a lot of places are using the term micro-credential instead. And it's much more acceptable in those decision maker circles. But it means the exact same thing as digital badging. So we partnered, we have a local ISTE affiliate called Actum, and we partnered with them and then collaborated with Digital Promise, and we've started the iLearn Maine Educator Micro-Credential Program. And we're getting educators in Maine to design micro-credentials focused on learning through technology that other educators in Maine can earn. And we're doing this through the Digital Promise Educator Micro-Credential System. So we decided that we didn't want to do micro-credentials in just anything. We wanted to do micro-credentials specifically about behaviors, classroom behaviors, pedagogies that we wanted to really promote in school. So can a teacher use the device themselves? If every kid in the room has technology, does the teacher have some classroom management strategies beyond taking the device away or sending the student to the principal? Some of these you saw before in our plain English curriculum model. So do you have some strategies? I don't know if you guys have kids who aren't motivated. We hear that happens in Maine schools sometime. Maybe it happens in Illinois schools too. But wouldn't you love to have some strategies on how to increase that student motivation? And especially in the context of one-to-one initiatives, if every kid's got a device, then it's not just the computer teacher or the librarian's responsibility to teach digital citizenship. Everybody does. And then what are some strategies for building foundational knowledge or practice and deepening understanding or putting knowledge to use? How can we use tech for learning progress management? How can we help personalize learning? It's much easier with technology to create options so that Irene is doing something different than Kelly is doing different from Lucy. But all toward the exact same learning target. And how can we use tech to support independent learning? There's a blog I did not include on my sheet back and include it called the Multiple Pathways blog. And there's a link there to a kindergarten teacher who uses QR codes. So her students always know exactly what they're supposed to be doing. It's made them quite independent. And we talked a little bit about assessment, evidence of feedback, but also can you maintain a strong homeschool connection through technology? So these are the behaviors we really want to nudge. And as I mentioned, Digital Promise has launched a micro-credential program for educators. I think right now they're up to almost 200 different micro-credentials. We have four of those so far. We have a lot more work to do. But the two things that we really liked about their program is that the competency that you want demonstrated, that you want to earn the badge for, has to be a research-based practice. So there's a research base for this practice. And then the other thing is it's competency-based. So there's two kinds of micro-credentials. One is participation-based. Like you might get a micro-credential just for attending Lucy's webinar tonight on February 20th. But the only criteria is that you participated. The other competency-based. So if you went back and applied in your classroom using Twitter for professional development, you collected some evidence that you did that, and there were a badge along those lines, you would be able to show that you went back and applied those skills and you've developed those skills. That's competency-based, and that's what the Digital Promise ones are. And one of the reasons that we like this program. And so part of the idea around a micro-credentialing system is that you've got some desired outcome. Those are the professional learning terms, but there's lots of ways to learn it. So Irene already knows how to do this skill. Kelly loves to read and is going to do it in a book, pick up a book or some articles and figure it out. And Lucy is going to go to our workshop. What you all will do is put together your evidence of learning, of having that skill. And then when you submit it, assessors look at your evidence and they either give you some feedback and ask you to retry, or they say, there, you have your evidence that you have this skill, and award you the micro-credential. And that's really the power of micro-credentials. And then there is a standard called the Open Badges Standard that it's really a good idea if any micro-credential you can earn is Open Badges compliant. Because think of it as the information that's on the back of the badge. These badges are a little piece of digital technology, and what they've got is information on the back describing what the micro-credential is about, what the criteria was for earning it, who the issuer was, what the evidence you submitted was, what date you earned it. If it's only good for a certain amount of time, what date do you need to renew? That kind of information. Now, badges are a decentralized professional learning system. So anybody can offer a micro-credential for anything. And there is no single authority that offers them. And I don't think there should be. So then this information on the back of the badge is what's so important, because the information on the back of the badge then is what, for example, your principal might look at and say, oh, well, this one was issued by Digital Promise. I trust them. Or they might say, gee, I don't know this issuer. The criteria looks like something that I would value. And they could look at your actual evidence and they could say, well, yeah, Lucy, absolutely, you did earn this. So the validity comes from this information about what you did to earn it, as opposed to from it being from some centralized issuer that has the overarching. So anytime you're somewhere and they say they have badges, you want to ask them, are your badges Open Badges compliant? They may not, but you can follow that up by saying, what's your plan for making them Open Badges compliant? The other thing is you want to be able to share your badges from all over. With LinkedIn, for example, allows you to post all your badges. It is Open Badges compliant. And so if you have someone who's issuing a badge that you can't post because it's not Open Badges compliant, that you have to go back to their system, and that's the only place you can do it, well, that's not as helpful as a badge that you can show more readily. So for example, I tease my friends at Apple all the time. They have a really great program, the teacher educator program, where you can take a bunch of little online sessions and learn about how to use the basic apps on your iPad or your MacBook, and you earn a badge, but it's not open badges compliant. You can't share it anywhere. And I harass them about that all the time. So it's a great idea to ask, and that doesn't mean it's bad. It doesn't mean that you shouldn't participate in that work. It just means we want to nudge everybody towards making sure that they're open compliant, because it's better for us who have the badges to be able to share them and show what we know. So this is, I provide that context. I want to figure out how to stop share.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the Digital Promise site? Like, do you have to pay for it, or how does it work exactly?
No, right now it's all free. I think what's happening, and there's some really great organizations that are collaborating with them. If you look at the list of organizations that are producing stuff, it's a lot of the folks doing really great work in education anyway. Their first set of micro-credentials, for example, were deeper learning. They have about 40 deeper learning micro-credentials that comes from the Hewlett Foundation work around deeper learning. And right now, I don't know for sure. I think they guarantee that the first 50 for any micro-credential will be free, because they figure that that's kind of truthing. And then I don't know whether an organization charges for that or not. So, for example, we're setting up a modest payment system for our app developers, our micro-credential developers, and our micro-credential assessors, just to cover their time so that as they review the evidence that's submitted, they're not just volunteering their time. But the state is paying for that because we want to encourage for main educators. The other cool thing is that the Digital Promise platform is open to all educators in the United States. So we've got four up there that are part of the iLearn Main Educator Micro-Credential Program. But our very first person who earned it, teacher in Tennessee. So, but there's information about the badges right within the program. Okay, and they've got a pretty nice browsing system.
Yeah, I see that there's, I'm looking at their advisory board and that sort of thing. Yeah, I know that one of the groups that we do some work with, World Savvy, they partnered with a bunch of people and Digital Promise and did some global educator badges as well.
Yep.
So yep. Irene, you probably would be particularly interested in those. And I want to say that they came out maybe a year ago.
A year ago, November was when they first launched. And I'm very excited to say that the very first person who earned any of their micro-credentials was the main educator.
All right.
And the only reason we found out about that was because that educator blogged about it.
Okay.
And, but yeah, since then they've grown from 40 to almost 200 micro-credentials.
So I'm just trying to look at their site to see like where you log in. So here's their hub.
So when you, there's no real login.
Yeah, it's a turn now. Oh, it's with Bloomboard. That's what it's with. Okay. That's the platform.
Yep. Okay. And one of the nice things about Bloomboard, they're currently the only platform. There's several platforms that will allow you to share your micro-credentials, but there aren't platforms that allow you to submit evidence and communicate with the evaluators and then receive your micro-credentials and store them. And that's what Bloomboard built.
Okay. Yeah, I have another ADE friend who is doing stuff with Bloomboard too, and I have to pass. She sent me a whole bunch of stuff that she... that her district's doing, and I've been meaning to share it with this class, and I haven't done it yet. I need to remember to do that.
So all Digital Promise micro-credentials are on Bloomboard, but not all micro-credentials on Bloomboard are Digital Promise micro-credentials.
Got it.
And okay. So if you just go into Bloomboard and you're looking other places, you might find, there's a broad spectrum of what's available there.
Yeah, wow. This is a lot of stuff in here right now. Wow. Oh, yeah, here's the deeper learning ones. Wow. I haven't really dug into this, so this is great. This is really
Yeah, it's really worth taking a few minutes and just browsing.
Okay. Awesome. Okay. All right. I got it. Anybody else have questions? Irene said, do you have a link to the global ones? This is where I'm looking right now, yep. Irene, and I don't know. The global ones have got to be in here somewhere.
Irene, go into the, I think it's either digitalpromise.bloomboard.com or it's, I think it's digitalpromise.bloomboard.com. And then there's a search, an easy search, and just put the word global and they'll come right up.
Okay. I'll look for it. This is great. This is really useful. So tell me again where you are in the stage of this. You've had a few people do this.
Yeah. So we've set up we got a bunch of educator volunteers, and we worked with four or five of them right off the top that were ready to go, and we worked with them. Digital Promise has a really nice coaching approach to developing micro-credentials. They don't just have people submit them and then they approve them or not. They really work with you because they take a little time to get used to how do you make a good one. And they coach you through how do you make the key component of the competency, and looking up the resources and how to write the rubric and things like that. They really provide a lot of support. What slowed us down a little bit is that we're in the middle of doing a RFP, professional learning services, a request for proposal. And so everyone who is proposing in that we can't have ongoing conversations with them. So we've had to step back from our micro-credential work. And in case Digital Promise is one of those proposers.
Yep.
And we're almost done with that cycle. And once we contact all the bidders and let them know whether we'd like to pursue a contract or not, then we can get back to this.
Okay. Yeah, I'm having a hard time finding the global thing. I mean, there's a link on their website. It says educator micro-credentials earn now. So you click on there and it shows you all the providers. And there's also, yeah, this is the same thing. And then there's a pull-down menu, and it shows you, you know, explore micro-credentials related to this, this, and that. And I don't see the global ones. Oh, wait. Yep, here they are. Global competence. Here they are. There's a pull-down menu. Here's the link, Irene. That should be it. It looks like there's four sets of them. That's cool. Okay. This is awesome. This is really great. And do you know of any other states that are doing this too, Mike, or are you guys kind of the pioneers here?
There are some, we're one of the first statewide partnerships with them. I think since we got started, other states have started conversations with them. And then of course there's some large districts that would be larger than Maine if it were a single district, that are getting involved. So, that very first page, before you click on earn a micro-credential and that gets you to the collection, there's some good articles there, including about some of the districts and how they're using them.
Okay. Yeah, this is really, I knew about this, but I haven't really looked at it. On Saturday, we're having a conversation with Chrome Warrior, which is a platform that I learned about from people at Q for their events. One of their volunteers found it. It's a company based in Seattle, and you can create your own challenges for professional learning, however you want to do it. Oh, it's a gamified environment. And and what the cool part of it is that when you make these challenges, they're called sorties. They all go into a library with other districts. So you can copy and reuse other challenges from other districts. And this company started by, I think, two guys who actually did corporate stuff. So like they were maybe from Minnesota originally or something, people who had to do snowmobile safety training. And this was the platform to teach people how to do that. And it's, I like it a lot. And we use it, we used it for our Global Ed Conference because a lot of people want, they want a certificate for attending, but I feel like the attendance piece is so passive. And I really wanted evidence of them actually engaging in the community and exploring all the things that we had to offer in the conference. And so I think we had about 200 people participate, and I'd say half of them probably got, you know, did the whole thing. I could be wrong. It might be a little bit more than that. But it wasn't bad for our first year. We also used a company called Badge List the first 2 years, which are our two guys in a startup in San Francisco. And I like that a lot too. But this is a little bit different. Like, I kind of like the idea that, you know, that maybe the digital, having digital, using the digital promise badges might lend itself to more credibility, and, you know, somehow down the road.
Yep. One of their major goals is to show that educator and professional micro credentials are serious and professional. And so that's their goal. The keep in mind though that there are some perfectly legitimate things we may want to award micro credentials for that don't fit their framework. So for example, the first box in our 12 items was personal use. Do you know how to use a computer yourself? Well, there's no research that says that's a good thing or that kids learn better when you do that. It's just kind of common sense that if you know how to use it. So what we may do, for example, is for our schools that are MacBook and iPad based, is one way to earn the personal use badge might be you get the Apple teacher training badge, which is not open badges, but we can certainly give an open badges compliant micro credential for you to know how to use your own device. And anyone who shows they have these basic competencies could earn it. And one way to earn it is by doing the Apple Educator program. So you could do it multiple ways. So we're looking now at, for example, Bloomboard. What do we need to do so that we can post some other micro-credentials that we'd like to offer, but they're not what we would offer through Digital Promise just because there's no research base for them. So depending on what your challenges are, they may be the kind of thing that you really want to show that you completed it, not just participated, but completed and you did the whole thing. And that you didn't just attend. And that would be something that you would do that maybe would not be a Digital Promise badge, but would be a really good micro-credential to earn all this thing.
Okay. This is awesome. This is great. Do you guys, Irene and Kelly, do you guys have any questions about this? They're quiet. They're exploring the badges there. You do have one. Okay, she has one. If you want to ask it, Kelly, you can unmute and actually talk. If you, I don't have to translate for you. It's up to you. So we saw the lady. She shared the badging. Who was it last week? It was, who were our speakers last week? Blah, 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 blah. It was Christine DiPaolo and Carolyn Skiba. I don't think they did badging though. It was Julie Keene from Participate, Kelly. Is that who you're thinking about? The summer program. Oh, so that was Carolyn Skiba. So Carolyn Skiba, who's an ADE here, you may know her, Mike. She's great. They did a camp.
The name's familiar.
They did it. She's at Burley School, which reminds me a lot of they kind of emulate the same kind of philosophy that you do about pedagogy driving the use of technology. And they did a camp. It was a Weebly's Burley Tech Camp. That's what it was called. And I don't know how they did the badging. I can't remember what she did, but basically they did informal things more for tech literacies, it seemed like, than the pedagogical piece. But I could be wrong. I didn't look at it. Here's the link to it. And I don't think it was to, I can't remember if they actually used badges or not. Did they, Kelly?
It looks like they did. There's a,
they create their own photo on the front. They create their own challenges, and to earn your badge, complete one blog post to share. Like, for instance, one of the challenges, this is where Mike would probably push back on, is that this was really focused on the tools.
So let me say this though. I noticed that you said it seemed to be more personalized and fun. I think more personalized and more fun is better than less personalized and less fun. There's a place for participation badges over competency-based, but I can tell you we're really interested in supporting micro-credentials that help drive changes in teacher practice. I also believe that badges around simple digital literacy pieces, like how to use this tool or how to use that tool, has a role. I hate to see those in the absence of going to the next step and saying, how do you use it for learning? Otherwise, you get teachers who just collect a whole lot of badges around the tech and not around the learning through tech. The becoming more familiar with the tools, I think that's an absolutely legitimate step, especially when it is supported by then taking it to the next level and thinking about how it can be used for learning. I can tell you too that in my own experience, it's harder to teach the tool than go and teach the pedagogy and figure out how to implement the tool than it is to teach the pedagogy and then quickly teach the tool on how to do the pedagogy. And I can spend a lot less time teaching this tech tool and teachers still leave knowing how to use it well. And that's because it's in context. I'll go back to when I was first teaching computer skills. I had I taught a computer course. Now, it was early days, no internet. I had a lab, and we taught kids how to do word processing, for example. Very few kids had computers at home. And we taught it well enough that almost everybody got an A or B on the word processing test. But 3 weeks later, they'd be back and saying, I have a paper to write. Can you show me how to use the word processor again? And because we taught it out of context, they didn't remember how to use it. So at my next job, we had a lab, but we only taught the computer skills when they were getting ready to apply them. So we only taught word processing when they had a paper to write. And then we discovered that we had to spend so much less time on how to learn to use the tool, and kids left knowing much more about the tool. So that's what we're kind of aiming for with the professional learning too. Start with the pedagogy and teach the tool in the context of the pedagogy. I think through most of the state, you would find schools saying they have insufficient funding. And it seems like those budgets are getting tighter and tighter all the time. We're kind of divided north to south. In general, the more south you are, the better funded the schools are. In general, the farther north you are, the less well-funded the schools are. I don't know that I'm going to say they rely heavily on parent fundraising, other than I think classrooms regularly do parent fundraising. But frankly, we've got a lot of areas where the parents don't have a lot of extra funds to contribute. We do have a lot of schools that participate in online systems like GoFundMe, mm-hmm. and there's one about classrooms specifically. So I seen the question about about educators being afraid and would using it in a fun way remove that stigma. What we found is that if we teach them a fun way to use the technology, they go back in the class and just do that with their students. They don't actually integrate the technology. When we show them a learning challenge, if we can address a learning challenge they have with students through the technology, then they see the use for it and they go back and they use it. I do think that part of the being afraid is because a lot of professional learning is just the workshops. And we find that if I go back to those items in those three categories for proficiency-based professional development, if they have a chance to see what it looks like in action, they can become less afraid of it. When they know that they're being able to try it out, and that learning from the parts that don't work and getting better at it is part of the learning, and it counts for professional learning, they become less afraid when they know they have people there supporting them. In Maine, a lot of the fear is in places where they don't feel like they have support, or they're being told to do something and they don't know how to do it or what it looks like. And then they're kind of left hanging to figure it out on their own or not. Some of it is age-based, but not entirely. We've had some veteran teachers, you know, who are getting ready to retire, get re-energized and stay for several more years very, very productively. And we've had some young people straight out of college that have a very fixed mindset about how technology can work. But I think when teachers see how a piece of technology can help them in the classroom and benefit them, and they've got support to it, donors choose, thank you, that can help. I'm seeing here if a reflective piece was added about how to apply it. My experience is that doing something out of context and then reflecting on how it could be applied is not as impactful or makes as big a change as teaching it in the context of the change you want to see in the classroom. And there's no reason why PD can't be fun, even if it is a classroom application. I'm hoping that we're trying to make learning interesting and engaging for kids as well. And there's no doubt that for whatever professional learning experience we have, if we reflect on how to use it, we'll do better than if we don't reflect on it.
Mike, I really want to, can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can. Okay.
I really want to just comment and say how great it is to hear you say this, because last session, I had to take a class where I interviewed a classroom teacher on her use of technology in her classroom. So I was allowed to observe, and they were doing some kind of a free Photoshop program, and I sat and watched these kids struggle through this program for about an hour and a half, and it was so frustrating to watch. And I ended up asking one of the kids, what are you learning in your technology class? Because this was a social studies class that I observed. And they said that they're learning how to work on some other program entirely. So it wasn't the same program that they were working on. There was no collaboration. It was really frustrating. So it's really good to hear you kind of show how to pull it all together.
Thank you for reaffirming that. We've got a lot of experience in how do you make school change happen. I was lucky enough to be in the district that had the first one-to-one iPad initiative in primary grades in the whole country. And a lot of places put in new initiatives into place, and they even offer professional development. And they're certainly well-intentioned, but there's some critical pieces on how you do that that will make a difference on whether change happens in the classroom or not. So thanks for the vote of confidence.
I think we get so carried away with like what is cool and new and exciting, and we don't take time to delve into how it could look, you know, how it could really enhance the learning. You know, one resource that I think I've put into some of our coursework has been it may have been this school district I'm working with, is the Florida Tech Integration Matrix. If you Google Tech Integration Matrix, it will come up. It's not, it's several years old, I think, and I'm not sure if they've updated it at all, but I liked the idea that it has different levels of engagement with different learning environments in kind of a chart. And it has examples and lessons, you know, kind of it spells out what technology usage looks like in those particular scenarios. And there's usually a video with it and that sort of thing. And the Florida Center for something at University of South Florida put it together. And it's an interesting idea if you can keep it current. And I'd like to see multiple examples with that. The other one that's similar to it, there's one in Arizona that also does something like that, but I don't know how good it is in general. But those, I think that's what's been missing is more discussion. What does this look like and how do you deepen the learning? And I just don't think that U.S. schools in general as a whole, maybe this is a big generalization, are really good at this. I think it really varies from district to district, from state to state. Our friends in Australia and New Zealand seem to get this, the pedagogy, better than we do. And I wonder what we need to do to change that. Is it something that needs to be worked on? Like, do we need to teach it, inquiry?
We've got to be explicit about it. And I can tell you right now that this right here is my Trojan horse to get that done. If we're going to talk about technology, I want to talk about these five areas. How are we using, and I don't want to just hear about tools anymore, unless we're talking about practice and deepening understanding or putting knowledge to use or how we're going to do formative feedback or about what are the strategies that create the conditions for kids to be self-motivated. And the interesting thing about that is the research is really clear. Even the hardest, hard to teach kids, if you create those conditions, there's like six or eight, depends on who you read, but there's like five or eight key things that you create in your classroom. And even those hard to teach kids will be less hard to teach. And they still might be hard to love, but they'll be easier to teach.
Okay.
And so I really, really, I want conversations about technology to be the Trojan horse to have conversations about pedagogy. Because quite frankly, the one on here that is almost the only one we talk about is foundational knowledge. And how do we get access to the information? And maybe a little bit around testing, but not around evidence or formative feedback. And you might get a little bit around practice, especially with things like Kahoot and quiz type programs. But we really need to have more conversations about how do we deepen understanding? How do we put knowledge to use and what a critical piece of learning targets that is? The important role of formative feedback, which by the way, is the single most strongly supported pedagogical piece. If we worked on nothing else than formative feedback, we would have huge gains in student learning. And then how do we create the conditions for students to be motivated and engaged? And by the way, I don't mean entertained. I really do mean how do you get them motivated and engaged to learn the learning targets you have to teach? And kids, you know what? Sometimes we look at kids and we just go, it's your job to do it. You just should. But I would remind us of how we feel when we're sitting in our district-wide professional development and our principals say to us, it's your job, just do it. And you're not connected to it. You're not moved by it. So it's something we all can work on. So I want this to be my, I'm trying to find, there we go. I want this to be my secret Trojan horse into schools to talk about pedagogy and get us there. We don't have to become huge teaching masters. We don't all have to become the state teachers of the year. But if we all increased how much we tried to motivate kids, how much formative feedback we gave, still put a lot of energy and effort into foundational knowledge and practice, I think we'd have so much better gains.
That's going to be perfect for the school district that I'm working with currently. I'm going to actually recommend that they watch this webinar afterwards because this speaks to the step in the process for developing a tech and innovation plan. This speaks to that, the step right now, which is they've been developing a vision. And I think that we've gotten a little off track with focusing on the student learning piece. We're back on track, I think, now, but that's essentially, you know, where you want to go with this. And So anyway, they're also poised to, at the same time, not intentionally, but it can become more intentional. They're also working on formative assessment, from what I understand.
Yeah.
So that might be the entry point for them to kind of start, you know, deepening the conversations about this.
Lucy, I'd really encourage you to take a look at Bright Bites and the Teaching and Learning Survey also, because it provides it's built around a research-based framework. The survey itself is valid and reliable, and it will provide a ton of great information around not just where they are with access, but where they are with leadership and with use in the classroom and things like that.
How do you reference research quite a bit? What are your favorite resources for research? I mean, how do you, I think that's the gap between the classroom and policy is the research. I know there's tons of stuff going on there, but it doesn't get translated to the classroom level.
If you want low-hanging fruit, go into the Digital Promise micro-credential collection and say, these are the strategies we're going to focus on. Because you know, by design, every single one of those strategies has a research base. And when I say research, I don't necessarily mean the highfalutin randomized control trial and all of that. I just want some evidence that it's going to work.
Okay.
So I'm noticing Kelly asked, what might I do for PD in the summer for an educator? And I would point to two things. One is we do a summer institute in Maine, and the structure that we use is actually a strand structure. So rather than the state and national conferences where you pick and choose breakout sessions, and this is the conference that Lucy came to last year. When you sign up for a strand, and there's a strand leader, and you have about 2.5-3 hour blocks. So you end up with like 13 or 15 hours where you can do a deep dive into strategy. We had, Lucy did global education. We had someone there using,
I did YouTube.
I did
Global Ed for the keynote, and then I did YouTube, and I worked with the teachers for 2 days.
But it allowed Lucy to introduce you to YouTube, but then do a deep dive into the teaching and learning. And so we had teachers using GIS. We had all kinds of different stuff. So that kind of an institute format we like, because the strand promotes that deeper dive, instead of just attending a bunch of breakouts.
And they left with creating something too.
Right. And you were left with something to use in the classroom.
And that's going to be the other model that I really like is Q's Rockstar Camp, which is trying to be fun and exciting and whatever, but it's meant to elevate teachers as opposed to having, elevating, speakers that you bring in or whatever. And the idea is to kind of cheerlead them along, and they do, I don't know, maybe they have two different strands over two or three days, and they're spending at least 6 hours in each strand. So they're, again, they leave with something that's going to be applied in the classroom, as well.
So the other thing I'd think about doing, Kelly, is focus on micro-credentials. And you might even, and I don't know if you meant, for a group educators, you could bring together a group. You could have them explore the collection of micro credentials. You could have them start to think about collecting evidence. Now, some of those would require teachers to do something in the classroom. So you may not be able to collect all the evidence, but teachers might plan lessons. They may do the background reading. They may videos about the new skill and have a plan. But there, and even though everyone may be working on different micro credentials, they all could support each other and collaborate. Or maybe two or three teachers get together and decide they're going to work on the same one. But I think that gives the opportunity to empower teachers to help each other, plus allows teachers to really choose a strategy that correlates to some perceived immediate need in the classroom.
Okay, that's great. So I think this gives like another dimension. Everything that Mike has talked about gives another dimension to professional learning. And, I think Kelly and Irene are going to have the best benchmark projects because they've been in all these sessions and are getting all these ideas from really amazing people. But I think this is, I think there's a lot to think about here. Like, how do we deepen the professional development or professional learning process? How do we, you know, how do we go back to those five things? I'm going to keep referring back to what you've been saying here. When I'm designing this course too, because I'm kind of rewriting it, right? I'm in the stage right now where I'm kind of rewriting the last few weeks of it. And, you know, how can we focus on those things? Yep. Irene and Kelly, do you have anything else you want to offer, you know, say something to Mike about, or any comments or questions? Are you guys good? Yeah, I think the formative piece also, you know, I think that's what really sticks out to me too, is like, if we can really focus on that, that's going to, because I think everybody's so focused on test scores, if that's going to be what we have to address in order to get the leadership to buy into things, then maybe that's a starting point. Okay. So Mike, what are you guys up to next? What's your next thing? What are you planning for this summer and that sort of thing?
Yep. So we're getting started on planning our Summer Institute now. We don't even know who the keynoters are yet. We've got our first heads down, sleeves rolled up planning meetings scheduled for tomorrow. And we're moving forward. We're finishing up the RFP for professional learning services.
Yeah.
And part of that was I had a great team of reviewers that really looked at every single application from the perspective of what's the likelihood from what they wrote that they would help change teacher practice in the classroom.
Okay. That'll be interesting. That'll be really interesting to see. Yeah. Well, yeah. Who wins that contract? Because,
right,
I don't think a lot of the people who are up for that kind of bidding, you know, the providers that do it, they think that way. You know, it's very right. Tools focused and training focused.
Right. Yeah, we got a bunch of proposals. Even though we were very clear in our RFP about the teacher practices we wanted to see, we still got proposals that just said we'll do workshops on, for example, iBooks Author and iTunes U, and it's like, did you even read our RFP? And when I say which are the ones that are most likely to change classroom practice, by definition, that means they're the ones that would really have to be supportive and do it in a way where teachers feel empowered, not in a way where teachers feel like they're compelled.
Yeah, yeah. I gave the RFP to one group I do consulting work with, and I think they might have been a little perplexed by it.
I can tell you that we tried to leave it flexible.
Yeah.
And now that I'm reading the product from that, I would structure it slightly differently. I would say choose from A, B, or C. And I don't think it was that clear.
Yeah.
So perplexed may have been an understandable response.
I don't know about that, but. But I'm excited to see what you guys do next. And is there anything else coming with the micro-credentialing, you're tabling until this process is over, and then you ramp that up. I mean, how are you going to push that out?
We still have to work.
Educators?
Yeah, we've got, we're partnering with Actum, which is our localistic affiliate. And so they can help get the word out. We're a little behind on four or five different projects right now, and we need to get a handle on those, and then we're ready to dive back in and start marketing and promoting those micro-credentials, but also working with our next set of developers to get the next collection out.
So would the people whoever gets the RFP, whoever gets, you know, gets the contract for that, would they be incorporated into your micro-credentialing somehow too?
Not necessarily. That wasn't a requirement of the RFP, although there was one category of supporting our micro-credential work, but that's all behind the curtain work as opposed to creating micro-credentials and offering them to schools.
Okay, cool.
So, yeah, we think we might have some folks that will help us create more micro-credentials within our system. We think we might have some folks that are doing some high quality work around a specific content area. We might go back to one or two groups and say, could you do this piece of your program? And so we had a group that if we can go back and convince them to do a piece, might do some good leadership work for us. So those are the kinds of things we think are going to end up getting funded.
Oh, good. Well, I can't wait to see what happens. This is
yeah.
This is, the reason I wanted also to introduce, you know, the class to Mike, Irene and Kelly is that I think what's been going on in Maine, nobody's been doing it longer than they have, first of all. And I think following this story is really important because it's been quite a journey and yeah, they can do this because they're a small state. How many people do you have in your state? 600,000 people?
Or is that possibly. I know that we're at about 175,000 students K-12.
So you probably have more people than what I'm thinking.
But, maybe 1.2, 1.3 million.
Yeah. But and yeah, so yeah, you can be a little bit more nimble maybe.
Right.
Because you're smaller, but it would be really great if we saw more states take on thought leadership about all this stuff. And I don't feel like there's anything going on in Illinois at the state level that I know that there's something called Advanced Illinois or something that's working with leaders, but there's nothing that's really apparent to the teachers. And I think other states are a little bit more progressive in this way as well. So
a lot of the in quote unquote innovations that are happening in states right now seem to have less to do with what happens in the classroom and more to do with where kids can take their education.
Yep, exactly. So it'll be interesting to see what transpires in the next few years too.
Yep.
Better for worse. Okay, guys. Thank you for coming in on your holiday, everybody. And Mike, I don't know if you're home or if you're still snowshoeing, but I appreciate you. I appreciate you taking time to meet with us. It was great.
And you bet.
If I can ever do this again for you, I'm happy to return the favor. And Irene and Kelly, thanks again for coming too. I appreciate it. And I'll send you the recording when we're done. Okay.
Great. Thanks, Irene and Kelly. Thank you. Good night.